Hi, everybody. I grew up programming, and as such, I went right into computer science at Stanford here and started working on stuff there. And worked for a big company, worked for a small company, and decided it was time to do my own thing. But at that point that I was founding a business, I had had absolutely no formal business training, so I had to learn pretty much everything on the job. And when you have to do that, you end up building up this set of things that, gosh, I really wish that somebody had explained these things to me before I had gotten started. I might have been able to save a lot of time or made more money, et cetera. So every once in a while, I think about that, and I try to think about, like, what set of information would it really have been useful for me to have had in my hand when I was starting all this. And when I was on a plane flight to London about 4 months ago, and I had just gotten a MacBook Air, and I love these things, I decided to put its battery life to the test and see if I could go and write for the whole plane flight instead of watching three movies in an uncomfortable seat. And I wrote up a guide to stock and options. How many of you guys have actually seen this guide that I wrote up to stock and options? Cool, the two people I already know. What it is it's free for you guys to go and read. It's on Scribd. Just search for David Weekly Stock and Options. And it's about a 15-page document that just tries to explain to an intelligent layperson what the hell are stock and options. And maybe you think you know because, you know, you've been on E-Trade and you've bought some Netflix shares. Oops, that was a bad idea. But but it was interesting to me to be on the business side of things and have to really think about, you know, what are stocks and, you know, what does it mean to go and raise a round and what's actually happening and what actually happens in the event that your company is sold. I think it can surprise people the dynamics of what's included in a term sheet in terms of the potential outcomes for what employees make and for what investors make and the like. So I know that we've got some investor types in the room. I know that we've got some entrepreneur types in the room. I have no idea what how much background you guys have in terms of stocks and options. How many of you guys have presented or received a term sheet? Okay, about half the people in the room. Cool. How many of you guys have been part of a convertible debt round? Okay, cool, cool. So it's like a reasonable level of sophistication in the room. So just to give people a quick rundown, one of the interesting things about stocks is it's like the currency of a company, basically. You add up all of the stocks that exist outstanding, and that adds up to 100% ownership. When you do an investment round, you generally create new shares and sell those new shares to a new entity, and the creation of those new shares means that the percentage ownership that everybody else has goes down. Even though nobody actually took a share away from you, there's now more shares, so you have a smaller percentage of the total ownership of the company. And that process of finding out that your shares, where you still have the same number of shares, but it's worth a lower percentage, is called dilution, right? And this is a concept that a lot of people are familiar with. Some of the concepts that people are a little bit less familiar with are anti-dilution protections that investors receive in the case of a financing round. And some of these you have to be very, very careful with, because basically they entitle the investor to maintain their percentage ownership in the company at whatever rate the company is the company shares are selling for at that point in time. So you can find yourself in an awkward situation where, as a founder, maybe you've fought really hard for a high valuation because it feels important to you that, like, I am the founder of a $15 million company, right? And that's a really good feeling, especially when maybe you own a quarter of that company's stocks, or let's make the math easy, a third of that company's stocks, right? And so it's like, you know, I have $5 million, you know, and that feels really good. It's too bad you can't buy groceries with that. But what you can actually end up doing that works against you is if you have a really high valuation and then the next round you haven't significantly increased the valuation of your company, maybe you've done okay, but not as crazy as okay as people thought you were going to do. Maybe the economy has hit a hiccup. Maybe Greece has seceded from the EU. Who knows, right? But there are a lot of factors that are outside of your control. So if you get a really high valuation, you may end up actually putting yourself in trouble. Because what can then happen is if you have a flat or a down round, oftentimes the anti-dilution protections that are there in the investor agreements are so egregious that everyone agrees it just makes sense to rip up the capitalization table that determines who owns what and start over from scratch. And let me tell you, if you're a founder in that circumstance, things don't tend to look very good for you, because maybe you went in owning, you know, you and the employee team, you own 75% of the company, but at the end of that, you know, tear up and renegotiate, you know, maybe you'll be lucky to end up with, you know, 20, 25% of the company altogether. So a lot of people can end up really screwed over with what's called a recap. One example of this is about 2 months ago, I believe, a company called Gomez.com got sold for a couple hundred million dollars. It looked like a really good exit, right? The founder of Gomez, who founded it in 99 and worked on it for like 4 or 5 years, ended up making $3,000 off of the transaction because the casual agreements about, you know, who's going to get what are especially going to leave out the founders, but particularly any founders that have already left, right? One interesting exercise I've put together here was actually walking people through what does a capitalization table look like, how does it get built out, and what are some of the surprising findings from a liquidity event. So this is actually the first time I've walked through a spreadsheet like this in front of an audience. So let's see if this works out all right. Any questions so far? It will be in a second. Here we go. Okie doke. So let's say Alice and Bob are going to go start a company, right? So they say, you know, we're even, Steven, on this. We're partners on this thing. So let's both have 2 million shares of the company, a 50% ownership each, right? We're going to split it right down the middle. I don't know if you guys know about 83B elections, this U.S. securities law. Might be interesting, so I'm just going to throw this out. This is actually a bit of a diversion. How many of you guys actually are interested in U.S. options from the employee perspective? Okay, what the hell? All right. So this is one of these things that they don't teach you in business school that they should, and I wouldn't even know because I didn't go to business school. But when you get hired onto a startup, one of the reasons why people want to go and work for a startup is options, right? And what options are is the right to buy a certain number of shares at a certain fixed price, regardless of what happens to the underlying market price of that stock. Now, the hope is you come and you join a company, and you join a company very early on, so the company's stock is not worth very much yet, right? Because they haven't built very much, right? And so you get an option to purchase stock in that company at what the current market rate of the stock is, which is very, very low, right? Because the company's worthless because you haven't done anything yet. And then over the course of the next couple years, presumably, you go and work really hard as an employee and you make that company worth a whole lot of money, right? And so then that the market value of the stock is way, way, way higher than when you started, right? So the company's stock valuation goes through the roof. And now what you can do is you can exercise that option. You can purchase that stock from the company at that super low, crazy price, and then immediately turn around and sell it for this really, really high price, right? And so you end up pocketing the difference as capital gains. In that case, short-term capital gains, because you went and you sold you bought the stock and you turned around and sold it like a microsecond later, right? So that's less than a year, so short-term.
What happens with non-listed companies? Because this example was with listed companies.
No.
How can you evaluate the stock price?
Right. So that's a very good question. So, hey, if you're not on, say, NASDAQ and can't just look it up on finance.google.com, you know, how do you tell what the appropriate strike price is for the options? The glib answer is you make it up. And actually, that's exactly what was done 10 years ago, is that the board decides what is the common stock worth. And a good rule of thumb was usually about a sixth to a tenth of what preferred was currently selling for. So when a new investor comes on board, you're selling them preferred stock, right? And we can talk about some of the different clauses that differentiate preferred from common. But generally speaking, common stock would go for about a sixth to a tenth. Post Enron, there's some new rules got put in place that said you have to use a third-party auditor to figure out what common stock needs to be worth. That's called a 409A valuation. And these guys are dumb as bricks. It's really frustrating that you have to do this. But they end up, surprise, surprise, coming out with about a sixth of what preferred is worth. So, helpful?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So, at the point in time you get hired, the price that you have to pay for your options is called your strike price, right? And normally that vests, you get a certain pile of shares that you're allowed to exercise at that strike price, but you're actually, on your first day of employment, you're not allowed to exercise any of them, right? And then 1 year in, you hit your 1 year cliff, and you're allowed to exercise a quarter of them. And then every month thereafter, you get another 48th of them until 4 years after the date that you were hired as an employee of this startup, you now have the right to purchase all of those shares that you were granted in your option on your hire date. You have the right to exercise all of them, right? So you've vested your options, right? So it's a funny thing. You'll often note that people, for some weird reason, tend to leave companies about 4 years after they join them in Silicon Valley. And now you know one of the secrets why, is that they are fully vested, right? So that's very, very common in Silicon Valley to have a 1 year cliff on a four year vest. So the thinking is that, hey, wait, you're actually not allowed to do anything with those options until they vest. And if you leave the company, if you haven't vested, if you haven't exercised your options yet, you actually lose them 90 days after you leave, right? And so you maybe could go work for a company really hard for 2 years for sub-market pay, and then 2 years after you leave the company sells for a kajillion dollars, and you get how much? Nothing, because you don't have any stocks, and your options have gone away 90 days after you left the company, right? So a lot of people are somewhat surprised and disheartened to realize this, right?
Sorry, do most people get nothing in those cases, or is there not sometimes some sort of compromise whereby would they be, they can get a fraction of what they would have done had they stayed?
So the portion that you vested at the point that you leave or are fired, you are allowed to exercise that, but you only have a 90-day window in which you must exercise, or you lose the option to exercise.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
It does make sense, yeah.
So here's the bear trap.
Yeah.
And here, and I'm going to lay this out for you. The bear trap is, maybe you've been working for this company. Like, let's say, this is actually a close friend of mine had this happen to him. He was working for Digg. He got hired for Digg pretty early on, was like a senior system administrator there. And Digg did really well while he was there. It started dominating all the news sites. It was pretty clear that the future of journalism, the future of online news was going to be Digg.com. So after he had been there for about like 2.5 years, he said, wow, Digg's going great, so I definitely want to exercise my options, right? Because those are worth this huge pile of money now, right? And so I'll pay this tiny price to exercise them, and I'll get these stocks that are worth this much, and somebody's going to buy them for some unbelievable pile of money, or maybe they'll go public or something, but I don't need to worry about that. It's clearly a good idea, right? I pay this amount, I get stocks that are worth this amount. Like, this is an obvious transaction. So he went ahead and did it, and then he left Digg, and 2 years later, the IRS came knocking on his door. How many of you are familiar with alternative minimum tax? Okay, so the U.S. actually has got a really horrifically complicated tax code. In fact, they've got several sets of them that run in parallel. And so there's like the regular tax code, which is like, okay, you had this much income and this much was capital gains and this blah, blah, blah. You've got this parallel tax code called alternative minimum tax that was meant to catch loopholes in the super rich figuring out clever ways around having to actually pay tax with the regular tax code. So they created a whole new tax code called the alternative minimum tax to make sure that the super rich would at least have to pay this amount of tax. Like, and At the point in time that it was enacted, it had ended up affecting some tiny fraction of the population, like 0.1% of the population. But one of the things that it's actually grown in scope quite a bit, and one of the things that it catches is if you exercise a stock option, and at the point that you exercise, the market value of that stock option is higher than what you paid for it, alternative minimum tax treats that as income, as if somebody had just paid you that amount in cash on that day. Now, you'll note that in this case, my good friend did not actually receive any cash in his bank account. In fact, some cash left his bank account to go and purchase the shares, and he got a bunch of shares that are private, that he can't sell on a stock exchange, so fully illiquid assets. So the IRS came knocking and asked him for $200,000 that he didn't have. And this is not uncommon, by the way. This is the bear trap. So he ended up negotiating an agreement with the IRS where over the next 10 years he'd pay them an extra $20,000 a year. On top of whatever regular taxes he had to pay. Now, because in the interim, Digg had cratered. It became clear nobody was going to buy Digg. It became clear that Digg was not going to IPO. There was no secondary market for Digg. The IRS didn't care. So, avoid the bear trap, right? So what are some ways to avoid the bear trap, right? Well, it turns out that by the time people are in their second or third companies, they're aware of some very clever shit that you can do, like an 83B election. Now, let me tell you about this little magic trick, because it's pretty cool. So you might say, here you are on your first day of employment, right? There's nothing you can do with your options, right? You've got a year until your one-year anniversary hits until you can exercise a quarter of those options. Well, not exactly. It turns out that you can do something you can do something that's called a forward exercise. And in the case of a forward exercise, what you do is you say, I actually want to exercise my full four-year right to go and purchase all of my options today. Right? And you might say, that's not fair. You haven't vested those yet, right? Well, what those turn into is not common stock, but restricted stock. So what is this restricted stock? Well, what restricted stock is it's stock that the company can buy back from you at the price you paid for it. Okay? So what happens then is on your one-year anniversary date, one quarter of your restricted stock magically turns into common stock. A common stock the company can't take away from you, right? So you're vesting that restricted stock into common stock at the same rate as you would have been vesting your options. And you might say, well, that's kind of weird, right? You know, why would you want to do that? And the answer is that you can tell the IRS that same day that you exercised, that very first day that you went to go and work for the company, I'm willing to recognize the entire difference between the market value and what I paid all on this one day. Oh, which coincidentally happens to be zero because I paid full market rate for this, so this is a non-taxable transaction. And the IRS says, okay. So at that point, let's say on your first day of working for, let's say, Digg.com, so you think, okay, this company's got some reasonable prospects. I'm gonna do a full forward exercise. You work for the company for 2.5 years, and then you say, like, okay, I'm bored. I want to go do something else. Now, you haven't the company will buy back from you a year and a half, right? The year and a half that you haven't vested yet. But you actually get to keep the remaining 2.5 years, right? And it's a non-taxable transaction until the company goes in and sells or IPOs and the like. And then it's actually long-term capital gains, provided you've been holding onto those shares for more than 12 months, which is currently taxed at 15%, right? So not bad, especially given that short-term cap gains are taxed at, well, whatever your income bracket is, and if you had a really good liquidity event, it's going to be up there like 35, 38% or so, right? So you basically get half off your taxes also. So this is a very clever trick. The only thing is that you must file the 83B in a timely way, because if the IRS doesn't get it from you, then what happens is that as your restricted stock is vesting into common stock, each one of those events is treated as a taxable event under alternative minimum tax.
What's the time latency for this to file 83B?
Wow, it's a little over a month.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, if you end up joining a startup as an advisor or as an employee, I would recommend, basically, you want to do it almost immediately after you're hired to make sure that what you're paying is the market rate, right? To make sure it's a non-taxable transaction, and look at doing an 83B election.
So just to understand, the only comparison is with the 83B, I'm paying for it right in the first moment.
Yeah.
And with the normal stock option, if I'm not opting for the 83B, I'm just receiving them without paying, right? Or do I have to pay anyway?
No, so normally, if you're not paying, what's happening is that your options are vesting, which means that you are acquiring the right to purchase stock, but you're not acquiring stock, right?
That's what I understand.
Right. So with an 83B, what happens is you're acquiring stock, and you acquire restricted stock, and that restricted stock is turning into common stock.
Okay, I'm just thinking in payouts of the new employee. First option is I'm not doing 83B.
Mm-hmm.
I probably don't have to pay anything because it's part of the remuneration by the company, right?
Yep.
The second option is, I want to be better and smarter on the tech stuff. So I'm going for the 83B.
Yeah.
But then, do I have to pay for this vesting option, which is not vesting, but which is the restricted option? So there is no payout for the employee anyway. In both options. In both options, no payout by the employee to get the right or to get the vesting or the stock. You know what I mean?
You pay for the stocks.
Anyway, you pay
paying for your stock, and you do the
taxation lowering.
No, it requires cash out of your pocket.
Right.
So that's what I'm asking. So
right.
Those two alternatives, the second alternative is the 83B, requires a payout.
Cash out of your pocket, right.
Out of my pocket.
Right.
You mean
But you're acquiring stocks.
Yeah, of course,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah.
So that's the difference. With the first option,
if you're broke, you don't have any money, you're going to wait for your first paycheck before you can buy the stock.
Yeah. So the safest option is just to actually do nothing, to not exercise, not file an 83B, actually never exercise your options, and continue working for the company until there's a liquidity event, right? That's the safest thing to do, because you'll be sure you won't fall afoul of alternative minimum tax. While you will get taxed at income rates for the short-term capital gains that you'll make in the event that a company sells, like, you're doing the simplest thing. You don't have to, like, stay up at night worrying if the IRS is going to come after you, right? So that's the safest thing. The clever thing is to, on the day that you're hired, go and do a Ford exercise, if the company permits it, and immediately file your 83B, and that way, you know, even if you leave the company later, you'll still be holding common stock. So if the company eventually does well, you'll do well, et cetera. So.
I have a question.
Sure.
During the option programs in my company, what we faced is the definition of the good lever and a bad lever of the employee who's got the stock options. I mean, like, how it's usually done in the valley? What does it mean, a good lever? If the person got sick, do they have
these
stock options?
So you're not really allowed to retroactively take away the options that they've already vested. What you can do is, if somebody leaves on very good terms, or it was just part of a reduction in force, like you had to fire half the people in your company because you're having a downsizing, it was like they weren't bad people. Then you can extend that 90-day window to, like, we actually did this at PBWorks, to like a 2-year window. So if the company gets sold sometime within 2 years after they were let go, they'll still get a liquidity event out of that. So, but generally speaking, I'm not familiar with too many clauses that try and be punitive about your right to exercise if it was a firing versus just letting them go. But, okay. So back to this example here. The two founders, since they've just started a company, the company is worth pretty much nothing at all. They determine the fair market rate for my stock is a tenth of a penny, right? So to purchase 2 million options, it's going to cost $2,000, right? And so then both of them get 2 million shares of restricted stock in their company. Yeah, each of them. Yes. They then say, hey, we need to pay rent and the like. We need to buy a server maybe. So they've got these two friends, one of whom gives them $10,000 and the other gives them $5,000, like real small amounts of money, right? They say, cool, thanks. Let's say that the company is worth $135,000, right? So it's three cents a share, right? It's important that they do this, then they do this, right? Because, 10th of a penny, and now all of a sudden it's worth 30 times as much, right? So cool. After that's done.
Can you explain a little bit more, because I didn't quite catch it? So the total valuation of the company now is
$135,000.
So it used to be like
zero.
Not zero, but $4,000. Like $4,000.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not zero. Then you have $15K more.
Well, actually, what happened was it was $135,000, and then they put $15,000 of cash in the bank, and now it's worth $150,000. But yeah. So behind here, I have a spreadsheet where I'm going to walk you guys through. Let me see if I can make this a little helpfully bigger. Where's my zoom? View, zoom. Here we go. I got it right here. Cool. So it says fake corpse capitalization table, right? And so here we have the two founders, the CEO and the CTO, 2 million restricted shares each for a tenth of a penny each. And so we're looking at this as of June 2nd. They started the company and did their 83B election on June 1st. There's 4 million total shares outstanding, right? So 50% ownership, 50% ownership. Pretty straightforward. Then their friends go and invest. And this friend puts in $10,000 at 3 cents a share. And this friend puts in half as much, $5,000, at also the same 3 cents a share. So this guy's got 333,000 shares. This guy's got 166,000 shares. They've created new shares. So as before there were 4 million shares, now there's 4.5 million shares, right? So the percentage ownership of the company has gone down a little bit, but that's cool because the value of these 2 million shares has gone up, right? Yeah. So these investors, because in some cases, like in founder agreements, they won't have a one-year cliff, right? Because, hey, maybe we get in a big fight, after 7 months, but we've both been working for a $0 salary, so let's not have a one-year cliff, right? So, doink. So then over the next 2 years, they recruit 3 more people to come join their team. And this is always a really dicey affair, trying to figure out like who gets how many options. What it generally looks like is a really sharp power curve, right? So if you're the third hire versus the ninth hire versus the 12th hire, like whoa, you really want to be a single digit employee at a company, or your odds of being a millionaire after a transaction go down pretty dramatically, and that actually plays out pretty clearly here. But you're trying to judge, like, what kind of an impact is this going to make on the success of the company? If I hire this person, are they going to bring on a whole bunch of other people? Are they just clever technically? Or are they not only clever technically, but I think they're the sort of person who could go and run a 50-person engineering team, so I won't need to hire somebody else for that. There's a lot of this, like, mental calculus that you're doing, trying to figure out how many options to give to who. So just as a quick note here, friends that you raised $15,000 from, you said these guys are not super sophisticated. They're friends and family. We're not going to do a whole term sheet or anything like crazy like that. We're just going to actually sell them common stock, right? That's actually not uncommon, as it were. So the people that you hire, you're going to say, okay, let's just keep their common at 3 cents a share too. We're not going to like futz around with that. And then 2 years after they raised that round, they say, okay, it's time for us to get a real seed round, right? We're tired of just eating ramen all day long. So let's move up a fancier ramen brand. Let's raise $250,000 from some angels. Now these angel financiers are a little bit more sophisticated, right? A lot of angel rounds in the Valley are done on a convertible note. And what that is that's issuing new debt to the company. And that debt comes with a number of interesting clauses. Now, first off, to make sure that to the IRS and the like, it looks like more or less regular debt and not an equity instrument, there's actually a small amount of interest that's attached, usually like about 6%. It's not anything exciting. And trust me, the people who are giving out convertible debt are not counting on making their money from that 6%, right? So some of the clauses that are typically included in a convertible note are a liquidity multiple. So if the company sells before the next financing round, then they get back several times what they put in, right? And in common for that would be like a 3x liquidity multiple, for instance. So if I give you $100,000 as a bridge financing intending to bridge you to a Series A or real size financing, and you don't actually make it to that financing, you go ahead and sell anyhow, then I want three times my money back. One of the interesting parts about this is that you don't have to fight about what is the company worth, right? And that's actually one of the key parts about a convertible note financing, is that the two parties don't have to come to agreement about what is the company currently worth. Instead, what you do is one of the main terms that you'll put in is a discount. So it says, you know, hey, I'm expecting that this money is going to get you to a Series A financing. And as a result, I want this $250,000 to buy stock in that next round of financing, but because I came in early, I want a 20% discount on top of that. So
is it a usual discount over here? Hmm? Is it a usual discount over here?
Yeah, yeah. So usual is like about 20% to 30%. If it's more than 30%, you actually have a real danger that the people who do your Series A say, ah, you know, we're basically giving away the stock for free to these losers, right? And so that ends up creating a very difficult tension between venture capitalists and angels. And another thing that's become pretty common to put in is a cap, right? Where you say, let's say you do crazy, crazy well in this next round. I give you $250,000 now, because I'm an angel investor, I'm investing in your company, and then actually you do really well, and you get invested as like on a $40 million valuation. Now, even if that converts with a 20% discount, the percentage of your company that I now own is like, it doesn't make sense for me, right? It's like, I'm not gonna make my money back now unless you become like a $10 billion company, right? So to keep things interesting for me, what I wanna do is I wanna say, well, I'm counting on you to do well, but to make sure that our interests are aligned, I'm going to say that if your valuation in the next round is higher than $5 million, why don't we convert as if it was $5 million? That preserves a certain minimum percentage of the company. Right.
Then the discount is not working anymore, right? Because then it stopped at the $5 million cap, right? Or is the discount deducted from the $5 million then?
That depends on the particularities of that particular note, but the idea is the important part here, is that once it becomes clear that the company is doing really well, and is going to go for more than $5 million, now the angel doesn't need to worry, because the thing is that otherwise you run into this weird situation where the angel in your next financing wants your valuation to be as low as possible to preserve their ownership. But if you're shooting for the moon anyhow, it's like you want the angels to be aligned with you, right? So it's all about this delicate dance of aligning interests, like minimizing fights that don't need to happen, but corralling everyone to have the interests aligned that the company does really well.
What's the industry benchmark for liquidity?
What is an industry benchmark
for
liquidity?
The liquidity multiple, let's just say, okay, it's before next round it got sold. I don't know. Sake, but what happens? What's a
1x to 3x depending.
1x to 3x.
Yeah, if it's more than 3x, like that starts becoming a little rough. Because what that ends up creating is something that's called a liquidity overhang. So if you take a look at all of the liquidity, what liquidity preferences are is it says that if the company sells for X dollars, before anyone touches any of that, these amounts need to be paid out to some of the preferred shareholders. And then at that point, then Common can divide what's left. But that ends up creating really this overhang that you need to get past in order for Common to get anything that can be pretty scary. You know, if you, especially at like a 3x multiple, right? So you go and you raise $2 million on a 3x multiple, and all of a sudden, like, for any of the common holders to even have a penny, you need to sell the company for more than $6 million. You sell the company for $8 million, and common sitting around splitting $2 million, it's like, it can be really brutal, right? So liquidity overhang can really brutalize a company. And if you want to get, it can be very difficult to get rid of. You know, at some point, you can just sort of have a come to Jesus moment where you sit around with the investors and you say, "There's too much overhang. Like, let's cut it in half," right? And at some point, that might be the right thing for the company to do. But those are obviously very difficult and awkward conversations to have. So in this particular example, the angel investors have gone and given the company $250,000 on a convertible note. So let's take a look at what happens to the cap table here. So you'll notice we didn't actually give these guys any shares at all. So the percentage ownership they have of the company is nothing. But you have to be really careful because the debt actually comes due on these notes, usually 12 to 24 months after you go and you issue the notes. And if the company hasn't done a financing round and doesn't have the money to go and pay back the convertible note, your company's kind of in trouble. You have to be very careful with debt because in the sort of ranked ladder of who has what priority over determining what happens with the company, the top of the pile is debt holders, right? So let's say, you know, your company totally tanks, like you're not going to be getting more financing. You can't pay off the debt and these guys come knocking. They have the ability under U.S. law to say, "I'm taking control of the company." It's called a debtor in possession. Right. If you fail to honor your debt obligation. So it's that's the other like danger about using convertible financing. Now, like these most angels have better things to do than run your company and steal it from you and deal with the lawsuits that come out of that. So it's not a practical concern in terms of somebody like taking over your company. But it's a very serious thing to have your company owe debt to other people because they always come first. In any sort of renegotiation about like capitalization of the company, what's going to happen to the company, et cetera, the debt holders always come first. So just something to keep in mind when you're raising debt for your company. So the cap table looks mostly the same. You'll notice we hired three people. My first early hire gave 200,000 options. My second early hire gave 150,000 options. And then I hired this guy who seemed like he could be like a really good VP. And so I gave him 350,000 options. You know, all 4-year vesting. So they vested a little bit of that, and that's at three cents a share. Okay, back to our storyline. Now that I've got $250,000 in the bank, I go on a hiring spree and I hire 4 more employees. Because my company is doing really well, a VC firm offers to give me $1.1 million for 22% of the company. Typical is that a VC firm is going to look for anything from 15% for a crazy hot deal that they just, you know, need to have some piece of up to 40%. But sort of common would be like 25 to 35%. Something to keep in mind is that they have a limited amount of bandwidth and a lot of money, and so they need to put that money to work in big chunks. So sometimes people are surprised that VC firms don't give out smaller quantities of money to a larger number of companies, but really it's that they like to sit on the board. There's only so many boards you can meaningfully sit on, so that it ends up limiting the bandwidth of the VC firm. So this would actually be a very small round for a VC firm. Normally they would like to give like $4 or $5 million, whatever. But you're a very promising early stage company. So this would value the company at about 55 cents a share. And the terms on this are 1x participating preferred. So the 1x refers to the liquidity preference. So this says in the event of a sale, they get back 1x their money, so $1.1 million. And then what happens is after that, every 1 share of preferred gets turned into 1 share of common, and now they get to participate with their percentage as well, right? And deals you'll see in the Valley are about 50-50 as to whether or not they're participating preferred. It's in your best interest if this, the best thing for you as the entrepreneur is for this to be a 1x non-participating, right? Because then they have an option, right? And they have a, sorry, I should be careful with my words. They have a decision to make, right? And this decision that they have here, if this is 1x non-participating, is they can either get their money back and then that's it. They have no more rights to get any more money out of the company in the event of liquidity, or they convert every one share of preferred into common and share with how everyone else is doing, right? So that's kind of your ideal. If you're doing really well, you'll be able to negotiate a term like that in your term sheet. But it's about 50-50 whether you get participating preferred or not, right? Is everyone following this? Cool. All right. Is this helpful? Good info? Rockin'. Okay. So this VC firm is leading, and another firm says, oh, we want in too. And this is actually also really common in the Valley, that one firm will be the lead investor, one firm settles out terms, and everyone else says, I'm going to follow, right? Because what you never, ever, ever want is multiple firms trying to be in on the same deal, all trying to negotiate a deal, because then there's like, okay, well, you want this term, but he wanted this, right? And then... It's madness, right? So everyone kind of understands in the Valley that that's crazy, and so there'll be one lead investor who negotiates the terms with you, and then other folks who go and follow on. So they don't get the right to negotiate any of the terms; they just put in their money on the same exact terms. And so the lead investor almost always puts in more money than everyone else, and which is why everyone else says, "Well, you're putting in more money than me, so go ahead and get whatever terms you can out of these guys." So a second firm went and chipped in 500K on top of the 1.1. And this is important. The company said, I need you to set aside a pool of stock for future employees that you haven't yet hired, right? And this needs to be a certain percentage of the company shares. And commonly, that's like 10 to 15% of a company shares need to be allocated for employee options, right? Because otherwise, they worry about, okay, what happens if the day after we go and invest in you, you turn around and start trying to print all this money and dilute my ownership down because you're going in and granting it to yourselves, to other employees, et cetera. So I want to kind of fix that. And I want to say, no, I'm giving you 800,000 shares as part of that, right? So because this was a financing, the convertible debt converts, right? That's why it's called convertible debt, right? And so everyone had agreed it was going
to... Are these 800,000 shares taken from the founders?
They're not taken from anyone.
They're not taken, no. They're reserved.
Right. They're created completely...
Not from everybody.
They're new shares.
They're brand new common shares.
They are issued at this moment, right?
Well...
Do investors have to share also, or it's just founders?
They are not given to anybody. They're set, so
there will be
issues. If exercise the shareholders will be diluted.
Yeah, but are they
correct?
Only,
correct.
Like,
so if these are
from the founders' shares or from everybody's shares?
Everybody's.
Everybody's.
Right.
Okay.
So what has to happen is first these need to be assigned to somebody because I go and I hire somebody, right? So these are they start off unassigned, right? And then I say, oh, okay, well, Maria, I really want to hire her, right? And she's a senior VP, so I want to give her 100,000 options, right? And now they're assigned to her, but she's not a shareholder yet. She's just an option holder. Then Maria needs to exercise, and then Maria actually becomes a shareholder, but out of this pool.
All other shareholders are diluted in proportion.
Yes, but they're diluted. The right way to think about things is if, let's assume that all of the options that exist in the option pool are going to be assigned. And let's assume that all of the assigned options are going to be exercised, right?
Yeah.
So then what percentage of the company do I own at that point? Right? And so that's actually what the firm is going to be asking itself. So when the firm says, the firms are usually more concrete about the percentage they want to own than how much money they're willing to put in. They're willing to be flexible on how much they put in as long as they get an interesting percentage of the company, right? So they'll say, I want 22% of the company after it is taken into account that you have 800,000 shares that are going to be given to future employees, and assuming that all of those are going to be allocated, and assuming that all of those are going to be exercised. Understood that they're not. So things might work out better for me, right? It's possible that if the company sells shortly after this, if most of these shares are not allocated and not exercised, that I'll actually end up with larger than 22% of the company. Sweet, you know, but I want to protect my downside risk, right? And so that's why they'll usually ask for you to have an options pool set aside. That make sense? Cool. So now at this point we're big enough that we want to bring in this third party auditor to figure out what should we price options at for new employees, right? And they come back and they say, well, given that you just did a preferred round at 55 cents a share, 9 cents a share for common sounds right. Okay. So let's take a look at what things look like. And then the board accepts.
Okay.
Right. So let's take a look at what happens here. So we hired four more people after we raised the convertible note, right? So this is taking a look at the day after you raised your Series A, what does your cap table look like, right? So you got four people you hired, 50,000, 30,000, 40,000, 25,000 shares. These are all at 3 cents a share because the convertible note raise did not actually affect your share price. These people didn't buy shares at that point. So those guys are vesting that. I've got an options pool now that has 800,000 shares. We've got our original friends who came in and invested $10,000 and $5,000. We've got our three angel investors who were in on this who have now converted at a 20% discount, right? So given that the VC firm was getting 55 cents a share, these guys have their debt removed. So the company no longer owes that debt, right? The debt converted, it's gone. So people sometimes ask me like, well, what happens at the next financing round, the Series B? Like what happens to the debt holders? And the answer, there aren't any more debt holders, right? They converted their debt into equity, right? So these guys are holders, these three angels are now holders of Series A preferred stock, right? So they're, but they only had to pay 44 cents a share.
Why are they converted to preferred? Was that agreed?
Yes. So in a convertible note, you convert to whatever the terms are that the next investor is getting. And since the next investor is getting Series A shares, preferred shares, then that means that the angels all get Series A preferred shares.
I see.
But they're paying less, right? So they only pay 80% of what these VCs do. So they ended up paying 44 cents a share.
So that most usual when they get the same as the A round investor gets, right?
They get the exact same terms, just a lower price.
I see.
Yeah. So at this point, you know, we have the investors own almost 4 million shares, and you'll notice that, hey, that's actually kind of interesting because that's what the two co-founders own, right? We set aside this option pool, so there's now almost 10 million shares outstanding, right? So you have to take a little bit of a step back, you know, as the founder and CEO and say, well, I still only own 2 million shares, and now that represents about 20% of the company as opposed to the 50% that I started with, right? So you can start to see dilution in action here. Okay. So then the company hires seven more employees, works its ass off for another 2 years, and then a company buys Fake Corp. Yay! And offers $10 million of cash on the nose, exactly $10 million. So an interesting question here is like, okay, this person who was hired early, who wasn't a founder, you know, how much do they end up with from a $10 million acquisition? Now, early hire two has been working for the company for about 4 years at this point, right? So what do they end up getting? Well, let's work through the math. The VCs get their 1x liquidity preference back, and the angels too, because they actually converted on the same terms, which included the 1x liquidity preferences. Then there's let's assume that the employee options don't accelerate. We can talk about acceleration a bit if you'd like. And that leaves, on a cash basis, 95 cents a share left over for common, right? And I can walk you through the math on that. Now, this early hire two is about 2/3 of the way through his 150,000 options that he has to pay a strike price of 3 cents a share. That's a pretty nice differential, right? So he ends up getting about $95,000 before taxes, comes out to about, so pretty on the nose to guess 100K. Good work. Yeah, and so we can walk through here. Now this starts to look like what a real company's cap table looks like, right?
Where do you hire an accountant? Yeah. Not here, but on stage 1, 2?
Probably a little bit pre-Series A, certainly post-Series A. Like, because usually as part of a Series A, they'll ask for audited financials. But in most cases, they'll waive it for a year or two. Because they don't want you spending all of your time like dealing with Deloitte. They want you to actually be building a company. But they're required to ask that by their LPs, because VCs are not actually investing their own money. They're investing other people's money, and so they need to stay protected. So anyhow, here we go. We hired 7 more people for, you can begin to see the power curve here, that we've got 2 people of these 7 who we gave 8,000 options to, right, as opposed to these early hires who got hundreds of thousands of options. So it's like, it really matters what your hiring date was, right? And these guys are at 9 cents a share, which is what our third-party auditor said. And they're also obviously not quite as far through. They're vesting, right? And we took these from the options pool, which has a fair number of unallocated options, you know, still in it. So we didn't take any further investment, so this stuff all looks about the same. Obviously, the preferred shares don't vest, they own outright. So at the end of the day, let's scroll down here. So while there are 9.6 million total shares outstanding, the shares held, this is on a fully diluted basis, because again, assuming that everyone in the option pool got allocated, but wait, not everyone did. So how many common shares are actually out there and held? Well, about 8.5 million. Right? Yeah. So the offer price was for $10 million. The liquidity preferences took out about $1.9 million of that, right? And so that leaves over $8.1 million for all of common to split, right? Now the preferred goes and swaps on over to common and participates, because they're participating preferred. And so that leaves a grand total of 95 cents per share, right? So now you can see where we got 95 cents a share. And so now it's very straight math, just however many shares you owned, multiply by 95 cents, and that's how much cash is returned, right? So we can actually start computing the ROIs. So the VC firm, the lead VC firm put in $1.1 million. They get back their 1.1, and then they get a further almost $2 million on top of that. So they get back just north of $3 million for the 1.1 they put in. Not bad for 2 years' work, right? This is why people are interested in VC. But look at how things end up turning out for the angels, right? The angels here, the lead angel put in 150K and gets back $500,000, right? Even better. And what about your buddies, right, that bought common shares, and you were a little worried about screwing them over because you were only giving them common and not preferred, and they don't have any special rights, right? Your buddy put in $10,000, gets $300,000 back. He's now your friend for life, right? So pretty good ROI all around. So it's interesting that, like, you take a look at these guys right here, and they really they're getting like a few thousand bucks out of it, which is nice, but not enough to buy a home or put a down payment on a home. For the two founders here ended up with about $2 million each, right? Not bad. Then again, they put in a whole lot of years of work on this thing. It was very high risk, so was it worth it? Was it not? I hope you had a good time at any rate. So. Yeah. Yep. So another thing that's worth noting is that if you take a look back here on the after tax, after California tax, which is about 9%, and on everything, and federal tax, which is 15% on long-term capital gains, these guys actually managed to keep about 1.4 each, actually, in the bank. And oh, this is really a little sad, but these guys who joined you early get short-term cap gains, and so they had less, and then even more of that gets taken away. So that's a little bit of a sad story there. These guys who have been working for you for 2 years, only after tax end up with $15,000 for their 2 years of work. So you really want to be early to the table here, or be a seed investor, right? But anyhow, this is just an interesting walk down through what a fake company's capitalization table could look like, you know, as it started, as they get some money from friends and family, as they get some seed investment, as they get Series A, as they deal with convertible notes converting, and they deal with a final liquidity. Hopefully it gives you a little bit of an idea for what things can look like in the Valley. A random final note here, actually, is that the VCs are not happy about this outcome. And you might say, like, why? Like, Jesus, David, like 173% returns in 2 years sounds pretty freaking sweet. I'd love that for my retirement account if I could. And the answer is most of these VC firms are dealing with a fund that's many hundreds of millions of dollars, sometimes billions of dollars, right? And so they are looking at aggregate. They don't give a shit about your company. They care about the portfolio altogether. What is the portfolio making back? And they only have so many bullets to go and shoot, right? And then they bet on you, betting that your company was going to be a $1 billion company. And you sold for $10 million? You bastard, right? Now you're happy because you got $1.5 million in the bank, right? Like, and that's pretty nice. Like, that actually can buy a home in Silicon Valley, strangely enough. but for the VC, with $3 million returned, they've got a $300 million fund. They need to turn that $300 million fund into a $600 million return. Right? That's what their limited partners are counting on. So of the $600 million that they need to return, what percentage is $3 million? Like, and the answer is not enough, right? So you'll find in Silicon Valley that if the founders want to sell the company and there's a reasonable opportunity that's in front of them, the VCs are not going to block it. Right, because like they have the legal authority to, just to be clear. Preferred stock can say, like, no, I refuse to let you sell this company. But then you got to think about what kind of a situation are you setting up there. Right now, you got a bunch of people are running the company like, fuck this. Like, and your management is like, I wish we could have sold. And like, and VCs are not running the company, right? And so they know that if the management really wants to sell it, they can't get in management's way. Management runs the company. And things are a little bit different at a very large company where people, including senior management, become a little bit more interchangeable. But at a small company where you got like the founders who are going and running the thing, the founders run the show, right? So the VCs can't make you sell effectively, and they can't prevent you from selling effectively, just because they know that actually doesn't produce a positive outcome for them. That said, this outcome, not so happy about. Would they back the founder's next company? You bet your bottom. Because in good part, because these guys no longer need $1.4 million, right? Now they've got the luxury of being able to shoot for a whole lot more, right? So I mean, that can often be a problem for first-time founders. Is they're coming from nothing. They've got their student loans still, right? They've got very little money in the bank. They're thinking about buying their first house. And so like they're desperate to get any liquidity at all, right? So somebody who's starting from a place of having a little bit more money in the bank, you know, can afford to swing for the fences and do a big risky play where they're trying to build a $1 billion company. So one solution to that has been taking some money off the table in rounds on your way up. And this is actually getting to be pretty common. So if your company is doing really well, you're raising like a $20, $30 million round, it's not uncommon for the founders to take $500,000, $1 million off the table. Not like $5 million, not $10 million. Like it's not a big wealth creation event, but it's enough so it's like if you need to make a down payment on a house, you can do that. And that's actually really healthy for the company, and it's really healthy for the industry. It's taken the industry a long time to come around to this. Like Ron Conway was on stage like 4 years ago saying, this is bullshit, this is called bribing the founders to make a deal happen. Like he was violently against it. But Valley thinking has actually shifted to the point where it's like, otherwise you put the founder in this situation where they feel like they need to sell because they've got $50 in their bank account and an opportunity to make that $5 million and you're telling them no? It's like, it's not a setup that you want. So you give them 500K, you give them $1 million, and then they've got the incentive to go and like continue swinging and making something huge.
Isn't it still kind of mixed, the attitude towards that? Just sort of, for example, the Airbnb guys did that, and I think there was a letter that was leaked from one of their VCs saying they left a bad taste in town.
Well, in part, so Chamath's letter, in particular, was not talking about taking some liquidity off the table. It was that it was taking a huge amount of liquidity off the table, and it screwed over all the non-founders. That's what Chamath was upbraiding them for, was that in that case, it was just liquidity for the Facebook team and was not liquidity for anyone else. Now, one could argue about whether that was the right party to deliver that message. If you look online, you can see some interesting things. I think it's fair to say that you want to be fair to your employees. And if the founders are getting some liquidity, then should employees get some liquidity? Yeah. You know, particularly given what the base that they're getting liquidity from is on such a disproportionately different basis than the founders, that it's really only fair. So maybe you institute something that says that, hey, people can sell up to 5% of their shares as part of this next offering. And that's kind of what the play that Facebook ended up running with DST, and then that sort of opened the door for a lot of similar investments. Cool. All right.
Excellent.
Awesome.
May I ask a question?
Yeah.
That's I find a great guy and want him to be like very interested in our company's success, and I make a stock option, right? But in the first place, when it was the first four guys, I made like a share option. But there is some difference between the stock option and the options for the shares, the stock market option, sorry. When the company goes public, and then they have the right. I mean, I've been told lots of times to use this model because of the minority problems and so on. Could you comment on that, please?
I'm very sorry. I don't think I fully followed that.
The first four guys are becoming...
The founding team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The founding team are becoming the co-founders.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now we are making the papers for the new options. And they are supposed to be not options, not options for the stock, for the shares, but derivatives. Mm-hmm. I mean, they cannot actually buy the shares. Mm-hmm. They cannot only exchange it at the market. Is it like usual, or is it okay? Or?
That feels a lot more unusual to me. I mean, normally what you grant to employees is, you know, ISOs, you know, incentive stock options, where they have the option to purchase real common stock.
So they can purchase them.
Yeah. So, now, most employees are not very sophisticated with options or stock, and that's part of the reason why I wrote this guide, was to try and increase the overall awareness of what's what. So most employees treat their options grant like a lottery ticket. They don't understand it. They don't know what the numbers on the sheet of paper mean. You say that 20,000 options is going to possibly be a lot of money if I work hard. So I'll say, okay, I'll sign it and I'll work hard. And maybe some money will come to me or not. Most people don't actually end up exercising their options. I think in that sense, trying to make sure that people don't exercise their options because you're worried about exceeding the 500 shareholder limit before you need to publicly disclose information on your company kind of feels like overthinking the problem. I would just, one of the things I try to tell people is do whatever's vanilla, except for your business model, right? All of your company's craziness, ideally, should be concentrated in your business model, right? Because you really ought to be doing something big, crazy, astounding, audacious to go and change the world and make $1 billion, and nobody else is smart enough to go and see that and pursue that. Everything else about your company should just be as boring as possible, so that all of the focus is just on the amazing thing that you're doing for your business model.
Average.
Yeah.
Best practices.
Right.
Thank you again, David. Okay, we have other questions?
Yes, cool.